Thank you all for coming. Thank you to the House for this amazing event, and thank you to the previous speakers today and yesterday. I couldn't ask for a better setup of this previous panel today. I mean, it was unbelievable. Like, I have a slide for almost everything that people were raising, in that this is a little bit, it's not completely outside, but this is my suggestion for one place outside we can look. I talk about tradition, I talk about, I don't know, many things. Very exciting, so I'm very grateful to be here. I was also excited because at the very end, the concept of the commons was raised, and this is actually where I want to begin. So I think I'll just launch into it, and then hopefully there'll be time for Q&A at the end if I'm leaving anything out that people want to know. But I'll just start from there. So when I started thinking about copyright law, music, and technology things, this was in maybe 1996 or seven or so, and I had an advantage over many people because I grew up in a house with a person who was an expert in peasant land communes, which is my mother, who's a historian, who writes about enclosure movements in Russia and in England. And so I had an in-house consultant as I was started studying these things on communal property systems that have functioned historically over time. And this became really useful as rhetoric around privatization of culture started to rise up. So her work, my mother's work, focuses on common land ownership and resistance to top-down economic restructuring. And so I grew up hearing about property law as a place of negotiation, as well as something that was often a weapon used by the rich against the poor, or the powerful against the weak. And I also grew up learning about how peasants had their own ways of managing resources, but that those were often not recognized by kings, by lords, by industrialists, by economists, and the economists who advised those political and military leaders. And I also grew up hearing about the ingenious, resourceful, and creative ways that peasants assert community-defined rights, both with each other and against and in negotiation with legal systems. This is something that, as has already been well discussed, was not very well recognized by the representatives and agents of those legal systems. So when modernizers of the time in England, for example, looked at English peasants, they often saw a place with no rules, with sort of instinctual unthinking practices, and they argued in favor of introducing a new rational system of ownership that would bring in development and usher in a modern era of productivity. Which it did, but it was a modern era of production, and staggering inequality was at the heart of it, and that was created and maintained, especially by property law. And of course, similar arguments were made for these introduction of property rights across the world by imperialists and colonizers. And again, I'm talking about privatization first, but I think it's also important to recognize, as was raised earlier, that when the British were in Kenya, sometimes they argued that that farmers were communal and we therefore should privatize them. But then when farmers got really good at making money, they said, oh no, these are traditional people and we should foster their traditional practices and not let them be too individualistic. So there is a method of maintaining power at the heart of property rights, which even goes against an economic logic at times. That said, you can see the power to define property rights at the heart of all these systems that led to imperialism, colonialism, and the destruction of natural environments, ways of life, in what we often call the global south. But interestingly, it also occurred within Europe, among peasant land communes within Europe as well, although not structured around race in the same way. But what's interesting is how similar some of the rhetoric is, in that local practices were often described as disorderly or unproductive. And these new property rights that sprang up always seemed to solidify the displacement and disempowerment of communities. As well, of course, as denying humanity to, for example, Africans who were enslaved and taken to other parts of the world by defining them as property itself. So again, these struggles over definitions and what is and isn't to be owned is really at the heart of what you might also call, we've heard mafia capitalism today, you could say racial capitalism. I mean, I think it's all just capitalism, but with particular angles for kinds of discussion. This happened in England as well, though, massive dispossession of people from their land, which was consolidated in the hands of a few landlords, and peasants went to cities to look for work and ended up in factories where their lives were restructured around the needs of machines. This also led to the obscuring, property rights is really good at hiding the costs of certain kinds of actions of power, but make certain trade-offs seem acceptable and normal between pollution and factory-produced goods, between affordable sweets and the enslavement of people who cut and refine sugarcane, between the rights and lives of colonized people and the lives and rights of the people who colonized their lands. So property law has often developed in a way that hides these trade-offs by defining the proper way for human beings to have access to resources. So this concept, which is often exclusive, although again, I do think they will deploy openness when it is relevant to do so, but this concept is, I think, a dangerous one and a powerful one, this idea of property as something which is defined in a fixed and exclusive way. So this is mine, which means you can't have it and I can do whatever I like with it. Check the law, you'll see I'm right and the matter is over. Rather than when can I stop you from using this, when do you get to use it anyway, how much is it mine, how much is it yours, how much is it part of a community, how much does it belong to the earth? And what's kind of amazing, is again the normalization of one concept of property, which is something that's been talked about also in relation to intellectual property versus traditional knowledge, right? That it normalizes something as what we really mean by property, and then there's all this other stuff. And this is, you might say, a modern kind of property, and I say modern understanding the critiques that have been made and embodying that in the word modern, because in a way I'm arguing against modernity, in the sense that I'm arguing against solidifying these divisions. And so what I'm interested in is looking at people whose ways of life are often considered backward and also looking within traditions closer to home more and more to find some of these grains of practices. So the rudeness of the rude peasant is this insistence on a local way of being, and this is kind of why I call my talk Rude Citizenship. A way where your everyday allegiance is to your community, to the land you farmed, to the rhythms of your life. And this relates, I think, very well to music, although I haven't talked about it yet, because music is a practice that's embedded in a community. You can think of it as a resource, but it's also a thing that is done among people. And so modernizers who saw land use practices as backwards, you find very similar rhetoric around how people looked at and still look at people whose intellectual property practices don't fit what they think of as a rational system. But in fact, I would say those practices are very much concerned with a real future, a sustainable future, a future of living culture in which past and present are intertwined because it's a living system. And so one of my big conceptual points is just if we recognize modernity as a condition of a particular time that requires and is founded on internal displacement, so peasants going to the city, but also colonialism, imperialism, and the destruction of the environment, then we can say, okay, modernity is not maybe what we're going for, but we should think about the present and the future very much again, as emphasized in the earlier talk. We have to move away from some of the systems that have worked or have been in place and look outside them to the extent that we can, or look at people who have lived at once inside and outside these systems. As was mentioned, intellectual property functions best when treating culture as a kind of object, as something that can be traded. And music is not always an object, it's also a practice. So intellectual property law works quite well in places where the manufacture and circulation of objects has been industrialized on a mass scale. So music objects, like recordings, generate money for especially industrial producers and for creators whose method of work fit well within that production system, either because they are individuals or because they work within contractually defined relationships. So when I start my research in Jamaica, it's because it's a place with a music industry and a music scene and a music productivity that is global in scope, but is not rooted at the center of the systems of law and economics that that are supposedly structuring that system. Not to say it's outside of colonialism, but to say it's a music scene which has grown from, it's the first post-colonial popular music that became global. So it's grown from this condition, which is a modern condition. And at the same time, Jamaica is quite particular in some ways because it is a place where you have a popular music that is simultaneously resistant in a way that some popular music perhaps in produced in industrial cities and countries in the global north are not, because you have a literal majority of people who are structurally disenfranchised within Jamaica because its legal and economic system is still very much shaped by colonialism. So you have 95% of the population is identified as black and is also extremely poor, and then you have a very small minority of people who are in charge who are still much less likely to be black, or they're lighter skinned, and also equal numbers of white and Chinese people, and they are concentrated in the spaces of power. So what popular means there is popular among a disenfranchised majority. That's a little different, for example, than popular music that was discussed earlier, like the Carpenters or the Osmonds, which are popular among the mass, but that mass is a different mass. So the bodies matter, the histories matter for what the significance is of different cultural practices. And then in Jamaica as well, the state, although it is concentrated in that way, and there certainly is wealth, the state is not actually completely powerful in everyday life. It is structurally unsound to a certain extent. And so there's lots of cracks in the system where people can make their own cultural and social practices that are not actually very well regulated or seen. And the state doesn't quite have the power or the authority to regularly control it. And I should say, I meant to say at the beginning, but I was so excited by the earlier talk that I didn't get a chance to, we're at the 20th anniversary of James Scott's Seeing Like a State, which I try in my citation politics not to go too pale and male, but in this case, I think it's a book that is still useful in thinking about what's going to solve the kinds of social problems we have. I think trying to see like our state and trying to represent ourselves like a state is always going to lead certain communities and certain peoples into difficulty. And so that's another reason for looking outside. So in Jamaica, the legal system also, as was described before, is a holdover or has been a holdover from the colonial era. And this is particularly true for copyright, which essentially stayed the same from the time of English colonization. They took on the 1911, the last update was the 1911 Copyright Act, and that stayed the same until 1993 when they ostensibly updated it as they joined the World Intellectual Property Organization, although actually they've been continually found to be not in compliance of it up until, as far as I can tell, the present day. And so quite clearly you have a system where the law was designed explicitly not to benefit the majority of people in this region. It's not surprising that it doesn't reflect the interests of people, and it doesn't reflect their creative traditions and practices have been. So in fact, in Jamaica right now, I think it's not until 2013 that they took the white wigs off the judges. So you would go into court there and still see these performances of kind of British legal systems. It's something that was just never considered to apply to the vast majority of people in Jamaica. So my own work has been about how Jamaican musicians have oriented their practices around different interests and different ways of relating than what the law has assumed, because they've had spaces in which to do it that are outside of the scrutiny of law. Jamaican popular music and DJ culture has exploded outward from the island since the 60s, 70s. I mean, it started earlier, but really got huge 60s and 70s through the 80s and 90s. But what's very interesting is that a lot of the cultural authority for the music until very recently has remained in Jamaica. So even when the music goes global, Jamaican patois is still the dominant spoken form until very recently, even though that's not comprehensible to people outside Jamaica and some inside, but especially outside Jamaica. Certain kinds of bodily performance and style have stayed centered in this kind of local cycle of creative practices centered on things like street dance parties, which is, this is a little clip from one, that can only occur in poor neighborhoods because zoning laws don't allow for the kind of loud noises and occupation of space by poor people that are kind of at the heart of what a street party is. And so if you want to be involved in the music, you have to engage with this very local production style in which the authority has, again, historically stayed very much locally. And this is part of what makes the music very powerful, I think. So there are lots of ways of looking at subculture or looking at popular culture. But I think it is important to highlight for people who are from a community who are facing continual erasure or rewriting by dominant systems, that they make culture out of a sense of survival, a sense of need. It's not only to express yourself as an individual, but it's because you are not being seen or recognized in systems of power. And so even within Jamaica, it's not until very recently that local Jamaican music was played in many places in on Jamaican government radio. It took breaking of that monopoly to really start facilitating the rise of local music on the radio. Whatever music was popular among the poor was very much kept out of official cultural spaces. And in fact, I think to this day, there is still not a dedicated music venue in Kingston, the capital city, because music is so popular among the wrong people that you can't have a venue dedicated only to popular music. There's an opera house and there's a theater, but there's no popular music venue. They repurpose things like the cricket stadium for popular music. So I think this unwillingness to foster this culture has led to people actually pushing harder for their own cultural survival. And because they're outside to some extent these systems, their strategy comes from outside the worldview of the rulers and exploiters. And so it makes a claim for the right of colonized people to exist on their own terms in the modern world. So this is important for musicians, but I think this is relevant for everyone, especially now, right? This way of asserting cultural survival of an identity not fully created by colonial power. This doesn't mean that things like property rights have no role. I certainly wouldn't argue that Jamaicans or anyone shouldn't try to use the legal system in their favor. But since the system isn't designated to redistribute wealth from rich to poor, the energy of survival is going to drive this music in a way, I think, a more interesting direction than if it can participate fully in the sort of music industry market. And so this is part of why I centered on the concept of rudeness, because there's a way in which the very things that mark these creators as outsiders is the heart of some of their power, and it's what offends people who are invested in the property system as a kind of system of not just what is property, but what is proper. So it does matter who you're offending. This is Mike Pence, who I think we should be free to offend. But the idea is not all rudeness is the same, but that if we think of offending the assumptions and sensibilities of people and institutions that are invested in modernity as a sort of industrial capitalist colonialist system, then we need to look at what animates these practices beyond, that is so upsetting in these official positions of power. And I think it's important to note the sort of emotional response of people being offended, because I think it shows the investment in these power structures that is actually psychological, emotional, as well as financial and otherwise. I think they are linked. And so looking more at these places of uncivilization, of rudeness, can give us a hint for how to draw on these other ways of being, other ways of making culture that don't originate in colonizers' sets of rules. So like the peasant land commune, which was seen as stagnant and unproductive, but actually a lot of historical research suggests it is neither of those things. It was a living and is a living tradition. People innovated, people developed social institutions and cultural institutions that changed over time. There's a dense set of social relationships that structure how common things are used. And this, again, is something that you don't hear often when you talk to music industry people about what happens in Jamaica. They tend to say it's a free-for-all, it's unpredictable, there's no rules, nobody knows what's going on. But as someone who was involved in music when I first started doing this research, it was clear to me this was very complicated and sophisticated music that had many rules within it, structuring it, and that had social rules for how you engaged with it. But obviously those were things that were not recognized by the legal system. So I think looking in these places, again, is a sort of window not just into a past, but into these alternative paths. Because there's nothing in the history really of Jamaica or really of capitalism that suggests that the majority of people who are disenfranchised by the dominant system, including especially descendants of enslaved Africans and other dominated groups, are going to profit when private property laws are strongly enforced. But they're also not necessarily going to profit if they're not enforced. The devil is not in the details here. The devil is outside of the frame. I don't really want to talk about the devil, white or otherwise, so I'm going to set most of that aside and say that's part of the question of how people survive is one that goes much beyond copyright. How people survive economically is about redistribution of resources on a mass scale, and that's something that is quite different, I think, from restructuring different kinds of intellectual property laws. So that's why I start with rude citizenship, because I'm interested in these alternate ways of thinking about our social relationships to each other and to the state. I wondered, what does it mean to be a proper person in these different communities versus in the law? And this is what led me to look at copyright. So what's interesting is that in many ways, Jamaican musical practices and copyright complicate, transcend, and overflow a lot of the sort of foundational definitions, some of which are the musical work as an object, the author as an individual, and in some ways the citizen, the rights-bearing person. There are many other terms, originality as well, that don't fit very well with these practices. But I want to talk about just one or maybe two and play some musical examples. So this is one tradition, it should be familiar to many people here, I think, given who's been participating, that has many variants and shows how these musical practices overflow and transcend colonial boundaries between people, between musical recordings, and between the state and people. And the law has tried to define this and failed, for the most part, continues to fail to do so. So some of you will be familiar, hopefully, with this. Why is it not playing now? Oh no. There we go. Thank you. So, thank you. So, how many people have, you can turn it up. How many people have heard this before? A couple hands, a few hands, more hands. Good, all right. So, this is, thank you. This is the Stalag rhythm, first recorded in 1974 by a band of musicians. I can't name them all, but Ansel Collins was the leader and the producer was Winston Riley. It is part of a long tradition of shared cultural references and practices because that, as is mentioned before, that music has been reused over time with different vocalists on top of it. So I feel sure. Can you turn up? Thank you. Folks know this one.
Tell me, say one thing, and see if you understand. One thing, and see if you understand.
So 1974, this is 1982. Here's 1992. So obviously this has not stopped. I think Jay-Z used a sample from this last year or the year before. One website has cataloged 279 songs using this rhythm. The rhythm is the name for the instrumental part abstracted away from the vocals. Sometimes it just describes the bass and the drums, but often it also involves other parts of the instrument. And it's both more or less than a song. It's an element in a participatory musical experience. So clearly this doesn't fit with the formal assumptions of most intellectual property rules that were supposed to be in operation on the island of Jamaica. It transgresses the boundaries of the song because it's considered quite normal and usual, in fact a good idea, if you hear a song, to jump on the rhythm and sing sing your own version if you consider yourself any kind of singer. So you have what Manuel Marshall cleverly called the rhythm method, which is this practice that still is very, very common in Jamaica and has spread outside it, where you will see an artist with a familiar instrumental song behind them doing their own innovative vocal performance on top of it. And this was embodied in even the material aspect of record recordings because the vinyl records, which are, oh, they're on the right up here, in Jamaica, when they were pressed, they were often pressed with the instrumental of a song on the B-side. So when you bought a recording, embodied in it was the expectation that it might be a performance tool as well as a recording. It was sold with the idea that there was space for you to engage in a creative practice. And this is something that another clever, perhaps less witty, but also clever scholar has termed phonographic orality. So this is the idea that you use an oral tradition, one that is based in not in writing, but in utilizing memory and the body to fix and share knowledge in a community, but to do that also by means of audio recordings. So incorporating recordings into an oral tradition. So this is something that was also talked about earlier because people mostly did not write sheet music. The creation often happened in the studio, went straight to vinyl, but then immediately got incorporated into a performance practice. So in this practice, meaning is woven together across recordings, because when you hear a recording, you are aware often of the other songs that have existed on this rhythm. And so not only is it considered not cheating or free writing, but participatory, if ambitious, to jump on, for example, a classic rhythm. You have to try to stand up to all the people who came before you. But also you get to add your own spin on it. And these are normalized practices within the DJ culture tradition in Jamaica. And so there's many ways that this challenges, and I ran out of gifts here, I'm sorry, challenges a colonial worldview because it disrupts the idea of individualistic creative authority rooted in a song and a creator. Not because Jamaican artists aren't individuals with their own claims to originality, but because it's not defined the way the law and the industry would like to define it. The ways people embed individuality in their creative practice is not at the recording level. It's often at the level of vocal style so that they are recognizable, and it leads people to come to them rather than to the recordings in order to make use of that vocal style. But also the act of performing and also listening redraws a sort of linear notion of the relationship between people and culture across time itself, because you can hear the history of a rhythm when you hear the rhythm, if you know that history. And so because of the specifics of the Jamaican creative practice, it also matters that this roots knowledge and authority collectively in poor black people in Jamaica and not in other places. So this doesn't happen everywhere like this, but that's one of the things that's interesting about Jamaica is the particular conditions that actually root cultural authority in this community. So copyright law functions by drawing boundaries around cultural works and around the kinds of places where you need to get permission to interact with them. These communities aren't necessarily engaging in those boundaries, but they do have their own boundaries around what is acceptable or not acceptable, or what is possible or not as possible in the music practice. And a lot of that centers on the space in which music making happens. So for that, if you look at the site of the street dance, you get these spaces which are in neighborhoods that have bad reputations. So upper class people, they go there, but it's a bit on sufferance. You're expected to sort of respect and consider the site that you're in and be careful and be aware, and the people who live there are aware of you when you're there. So you have to enter a little bit on the terms of the people that are there. And again, you can't do this kind of engagement in upper class area because the spaces are much more regulated. So they continually flourish in spaces where upper class people do not have full control over the space. And even the police, although they show up in these spaces, do not have full control over these spaces. And so, ironically, the very social and legal regulations that exclude people mostly in these kind of spaces from spaces of power and from elite cultural spaces also allow them to maintain these spaces in which they have more control, in which they've created a musical culture which is actually globally powerful. And so you get these interesting intersections of people from outside Jamaica bypassing all the traditional gatekeepers of culture in the elite sections of Jamaica and coming straight to these areas. Obviously, it doesn't mean there's no power relations between outsiders and locals, but once you're physically there, you have to account for yourself at least a little bit, which is very interesting. And so this kind of local control, I think, is very crucial to how this power has been maintained over time within the music. This doesn't mean, though, that people are isolated. They're engaging with the global music landscape. And I want to give one example of that, if I can get my slide to advance. Can I have the sound up, please? If this works, it will be a miracle, but a happy one. Jamaicans don't just engage with music within their own community. They also engage with music that comes from outside into their own community. There's a global media landscape, and hip hop and pop music and country and all kinds of things filter in, and people engage with it. But there's ways in which the local practices allow folks to sort of reinscribe their way of being within these global media entities. So I'm just going to give you an example of one, which is, this is from 2009. I'm sure there's a more up-to-date one, but it's still one of my favorites. This is a song, if I get it right, that was big in 2009 in the US and became very big in Jamaica as well. Let's see if we can hear it. Yes. Anyone know this one? I can't see anybody. All right, so this is Mims. This is Why I'm Hot. I'll let it come in.
This is why I'm hot. This is why I'm hot.
I used to like to play this when I was entering to give a talk, because it's a great entry song.
This is why I'm hot. This is why, this is why, this is why I'm hot.
Okay, so you get the idea. This was huge in Jamaica, very popular song, but as happens with most popular songs that get big, it got reincorporated into the local practice. And so by the time I was there in 2009, you would hear that, and then you'd hear this.
This is where we at. 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 Why? Why? The girls said love me, so we know, say we at. At in up the chat, chat. This is where we at. Step up in the club of champagne. We are pop, pop. Serious, we serious and a chat. We are chat, chat. The girls said love me, cause we touch certain spot, man. This is why, this is why, this is where we at.
So did y'all hear that? The style algorithm comes in, right, in the end of the song there, or in the end of that intro section there. And that's important, because one of the things that's happening is this sort of injection of Jamaican musical knowledge, shared musical knowledge, into this dominant American pop tune, right? And it matters that it starts with an air horn siren, which is a very traditional common dance hall punctuation. And it's notable that Junior Reed sings in patois, although he's singing the same words in the beginning as Mims is saying. And then the first interjection is actually from a song that's usually identified as No, No, No by Don Penn. I did try to put the little label up there so you could catch that. And then you get the style algorithm, so you get immediately this sort of introduction of a song that goes all the way back to 1974 that everybody knows in Jamaica is globally popular and that is also locally popular. And so you get this kind of great interaction, I think, where, again, folks are engaging from their cultural references, but in the modern world, in the world of the present, in the world where American pop stars are also circulating their music. And this deliberate interaction, which is also not legal in many senses, is massively popular. So when I was in Jamaica at the time, everybody loved the Mims tune, it was very popular. But the minute this remix debuted, I happened to be there while it was debuting, when people realized that it was this remix and they heard these references to their own traditions and their own familiar musical references, people would just go crazy. It was the energy level would just go way up. And this is partly because of how it disrupts this kind of colonial set of structured relationships, I think. So the lineage of copyright, obviously many different entities make use of copyright, but there's this idea that you have originators who are authors. They're often not the owners because of a contract, so maybe that's where the ownership shifts. And the right to be an author is based in being different from what came before. But within the Jamaican sort of sonic lineage, any song that is popular will probably be going in a bunch of directions at once and is on purpose that it does that. It's not to say that music outside Jamaica doesn't do this, but that's certainly not how copyright law tracks anything that's happening in the music. But within Jamaica, it's incredibly important, and it helps you as a fan, but also as a performer and as an artist and as a creator, to know all of these ways that you're drawing on all of these shared pieces of knowledge. And so there's a way in which even originality itself is centered partly in communities. And what I think is great about this is that it's this different way of taking up space. Again, taking up space without abandoning all of these links to things that are outside or predate colonial power. And this is true in this global media environment, which is obviously, you know, completely constructed by these systems of power, by these international institutions, by these negotiating organizations, and so on. So they're not separate from capitalism or from the colonial state, but they're also not completely produced by it either. They're continually a little bit disruptive. They don't fit well. Again, they're in the World Intellectual Property Organization, but they're continually being censured for their failure to fully comply, even at the government level, which I think is kind of amazing, but also quite common in practice. What these rules mean on paper versus how they are lived is always interesting. So this question of how people are taking up space with the music, I think, is where the citizenship issue really comes into play, because they're claiming, I would suggest, a right to be present with all of their histories, with all of their relationships, engaging, you know, in pop music, which is a total product of an industrial capitalist system, and they're not staying outside of that, but they're bringing all these pieces with them. And this question of how, in the face of these structures, we claim a sense of belonging in the present to ourselves and to each other is really fundamentally important, and especially important now. It has different questions, of course, depending on who we are. Some of us benefit from injustice, while others are violated by it. So claiming a sense of belonging really depends on who we're going to be belonging to. But I think we can affirm the value of people who have been historically marginalized rudely claiming citizenship on their own terms. And because I do want to tie this again to different kinds of European traditions without erasing the specificity of Jamaica, I want to just highlight how this has echoes in a tradition that has been somewhat erased but is very interesting to me personally, which is this concept of doekate or here-ness, which is, doekate is Yiddish. It's a term that was centered by the Allgemeiner Jiddischer Arbeiterbund, which is a really interesting movement that happened in Europe before and during World War II. And part of the idea with this group, they are an anti-ethno-nationalist group of radical Jews who argued that the way to live in Europe at that time was not to carve out some separate religious homeland and define yourself as a member or an ethnic homeland, but to define yourself where you are and struggle for justice alongside your neighbors and claim dignity and rights based on your local relationships. And so I think this is really important, especially now. In the US and in Germany, people are at the borders. They're in cities, they're not recognized, they're not heard. And many are denied their rights to life and livelihood based on their relationship to the state. Reading the news today has been rough, sorry. What's happening in the border of Guatemala is very upsetting as well. So many are denied their rights to presence in this space because of their poor fit, because of their rudeness, because they are nicht in Ordnung, however you want to put it. But law and culture were never designed to fit everybody. And so we need a different kind of citizenship if we're going to get out of this mess. We need to listen to people where they are, and we need to affirm their relationships to their past, especially people whose pasts have been erased or have been attempted to be erased. We need to start there first. So I'll stop there before I lose it. Thank you.
That was brilliant. I really appreciated it. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the last thing that you presented, which is this idea of citizenship, which in and of itself, we might argue, needs to be decolonized. So can you talk a little bit about what it might look like to decolonize citizenship in kind of a more legal sense, like independent of the performative?
That's a great question. I think what's interesting to me is I've realized that some of the discussions around sort of what an ideal world look like are interesting to me because of how about when they stop. So like in an ideal world, the law will look like this, or in an ideal world, maybe there won't be any laws, won't be a state. Like, what are we trying to achieve? And I think rather than think about ideals, I tend to start from, again, here-ness, from where we are now. And so the things that most urgently need to be recognized are people's claims to life. And I think actually addressing those can make a lot of these other concerns much less urgent. So I think, you know, although we're talking about copyright, if we're talking about the survival of communities, you know, dealing with the lack of resources those communities have in a direct and material way would solve a lot more problems, I think, than designing a copyright law differently. I think that would be good, but I think, in fact, you know, addressing global climate change, and I know this is, sounds like a dodge, but I do think addressing those things is going to require restructuring all kinds of legal and economic frameworks. And I think that that actually is where we should start imagining what's going to happen, because otherwise all of these other changes are being asked to do the kind of work that actually they can't do. So this is sort of something I asked earlier, right, that I feel like copyright, you know, the reason why Jamaicans never made as much money as they should have off of the industry, even though the music is globally popular, is not because copyright was improperly enforced or improperly defined, in the sense that there's no way there ever could have been a law written that would have served their interest, because it wasn't designed to do that, and people in power weren't going to do it. So instead, I think, you know, and this is something when I did my fieldwork asking people in Jamaica what they wanted, most of what they said first, even in the music industry, was, you know, we need clean water, and we need investment in schools and education, and we need, you know, to have local autonomy over food and not have to buy everything on the open market. You know, the IMF came up more than once, right? So I do think citizenship is not just about being recognized, being seen by the state. That's the traditional definition, but I think this idea of decolonizing citizenship means starting first from what it is that people need and recognizing that, and the state should sort it out, which is, again, something that's kind of been come up before. So a lot of that means, I think, leaving space for unregulated things, not trying to design and regulate everything. I can talk more about the specifics, but I hope that kind of addresses the question.
Dr. Mann, that was fantastic. Thank you so much for your talk. So I've got a question for you that there's probably not a good answer to, but I'd like to hear you talk about it as you think about it, which is, you know, your argument for the political tactical value of rudeness is so apt and so historically true. And yet there's this kind of counter narrative happening right now where you have the rise, the re-rise of this kind of global extremist right, you know, fascism 2.0, whose brand is that they are uncivil, whose brand is that they're rude, they're speaking truth to the power of the global elites who want international accord and markets and global citizenship and, you know, us globalists who they're ostensibly revolting against, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
And at the same time, holding us to this double standard whenever anybody calls them out for doing what they're doing, accusing us of being uncivil.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess my question to you is, how can you valorize the tactical rudeness of the disempowered without providing a space of a permissive space around the rudeness of the right?
That is a great question, and I thought about that a lot in my talk. I couldn't address every aspect of it, but that's part of why when you say of the disempowered, right? That's key. And I tried to say, you know, bodies and location matter. So it's not rudeness across the board. But that's why I had, you know, I don't like to think about Mike Pence very much. But the idea is that who you offend, who is offended, matters here, because one set of offense is tied to offending the dominant norms of a system that justifies itself by trying not to think about itself. And then on the other side, you have the continual invasion of the personal space and world and cultural practices and bodies of people who are marginalized in relation to power, whether it's by colonization or by gender or whatever it is, right? And so, yeah, absolutely, I'm not arguing for rudeness in every direction at all. It actually links to something I was thinking before, too, that was said about whether artists should have to consider the law and how that's very constricting. And I agree with that, but for me, it's partly about the question of whether it's the law, because I also think the assumption that as a creator, you should never consider anybody else or your relationship to anyone else or your community, to me, it feels a little bit colonial. Like the idea that the world exists for you, for you as a playground. I mean, I understand the importance of being disruptive as an artist to some extent, but I also think some of the things we can learn from, you know, communities not only identified as indigenous, but all kinds of communities, is that it's important to at least have consideration for your relationships to other people when you do things, and that defining freedom as not having to consider anything, I think, is something we also could probably challenge. We don't have to structure it in terms of, you know, you must wear a tie and you must call everybody, you know, sir and ma'am or whatever, but thinking about what it would be to be conscious, sustainable, and respectful to communities around us, I think that's one of the sort of things also that modernity has done away with in a way that's been really harmful, again, environmentally, socially, in all kinds of ways. So yeah, I think it's important not to take rudeness as a generic term, but to say it has to be situated in relation to power in really particular ways. So thank you for letting me highlight that. Is over there.
Thank you for bringing some emotion into this as well. It's very, like, in these really challenging times. I'm thinking about how to use these kinds of cultural resources as a commons when things like corporate culture are not going to go away so easily, and they're profiting from these sorts of things,
mm-hmm.
on a big, you know, global scale where people are trying to do it on a local scale. Is there some kind of practice there in Jamaica or in any other examples that you can think of where the profits being made on the global level from some artists who create some commons community and put mm-hmm. that money back into their culture and their resources and their mm-hmm. you know, local scenes? Is there something we can do to make the commons out of, you know, what can be generated for profits on the global scale?
I would love to solve that problem, but I think coming from a historian's perspective on commonses, you know, when commonses function, it's because they are embedded in long-term social relationships where people see each other. I mean, like peasant land communes, you know, people knew each other through generations, and it didn't mean that nobody ever left or came in, but it meant that the reason why people didn't you know, overgraze is because they had to go home, you know, and pass their neighbor, and their neighbor would be upset if they were to, you know, disrespect aspects of, you know, that sort of communal land structure. And so I think in relation to sort of cultural works, looking at how people make things in community and how they can define things to control the ways they produce those things is likely to be, to me, the starting point. I mean, I guess, you know, to the extent that I'm in a Western tradition, maybe anarcho-syndicalism is the closest, but, you know, affiliating with people who are where you are and trying to define your relationship to each other and to resources where you are, I think, is important. Whether that's going to, again, like, topple global systems of capital, I'm not sure, but, again, I think these creative practices are not designed to do that, in my mind. A lot of what cultural practices do, they do provide money for people who can sell things in relation to it or sell their own performances, but they also shore up these identities and ways of relating that are somewhat rooted outside these systems of power, and it's important to be able to create and recreate and engage in those things in order to go out and, you know, fight and, like, organize a union and, like, lie down in front of a bulldozer and all those things. It's important to have spaces of cultural autonomy to some extent, not in an isolated way, but in a sort of self-directed way. And so at the same time, I think there have been really interesting moments, even within law, where sort of communities of producers have carved out little exceptions, limitations for themselves. And all of those little spaces, I think, are interesting to look at. I also think having unregulated spaces is key as well, which is one of the reasons why the sort of digital era is a bit demoralizing, because everything is visible online and potentially regulated. And I think this can be quite detrimental because of the unwillingness of people to build consent, for example, into the internet. So the default is that you don't consent that you do consent to anything that is done to you or your data as you participate. And that's, again, a kind of colonial assumption of what it means to participate in these public spaces. You know, that there's plenty of places where you can't interact as you please, but online, the only people who benefit from them are those who are insulated from the worst outcomes. So I think carving out spaces of community control and power based on where people are in their relationships to each other, again, this kind of here-ness is, for me anyways, the one place I can look to find some hope right now. I hope that answered. Other questions in the back?
Hi. I have a question to something you said before, an answer about that Jamaicans producers didn't earn money, or they are not much, but not because of the copyright, mm-hmm. but because other things. And I kind of don't know which other things. I wanted to know if you could mm-hmm. talk about that.
Sure. So I should separate producers from what they call artistes, because to some extent producers were the people who ran the studios, and if anybody owned a copyright, it was very likely to be the person who owned the studio that everyone came to, because that's the point at which the recording got made, and so that's where a copyright could attach. At the same time, any money they made off that was not as much from local sales, because not many people bought records in Jamaica, only other sound systems bought records, pretty much, and everyone else, the vast majority of the public, heard music through going to these dances. So the money was coming from outside when there were sales overseas. So for artists who are especially vocalists, you built your individuality into your vocal performance when you were jumping on these different rhythms. People would come to know you, and then they would ask you to do things like, you would re-sing a famous song, but you would put the name of the person who commissioned you into the song, or the sound system, for example, into the song. So if you have a DJ crew and they're going to go play a party, they would find Sister Nancy and they would say, hey, can you do Bomb Bomb, but can you talk about our sound system and how great it is? And you would pay a substantial chunk of money, often if the song was really famous, to that person as a one-time fee, and then you'd take that customized recording, which only you would be relevant to you, and play it. Right, so it's a way of kind of creating that kind of scarcity in a different place, and creating permission, but in a different place. That had to do with the sort of the body of the performer as an authority through the through their sounds that they made. For musicians, it was a little different in that they often would be affiliated with a studio and get like a regular or irregular, but just get money, you know, as they got more respected. And they could sometimes defect to other studios. They weren't always tied to one. But they didn't necessarily have names that were known outside of the producer world as much, with some specific exceptions. And so it wasn't based, again, on royalties. Usually they just got money from the studios. I had a really fascinating experience with that when I was doing my fieldwork, one of those ones where you're like running to get the pen, because I was in a studio with Buru Bantan, who has a really famous tune, if you follow dancehall, called Boumoua Dis, that I can't attempt to sing, but it's a very striking tune. And he recorded it, I don't know, I think in the 80s. And I was in the studio with local but also international producers. There was a Spanish sound system DJ there. There was a Japanese guy. There was an Italian guy. And they all were asking him to re-sing this internationally famous song and drop their names in it. And literally in the middle of it, like, someone's like pulling out money to pay him a few hundred dollars, or like $700 in one case, for this one vocal performance that took him like, you know, 3 minutes. And he literally turned and said, "These are my royalties." And he didn't even, like, I didn't talk to him about what my research was. He was just kind of expounding on it. But I was like, yeah, okay, like, he can make money off this song as long as people are interested in this song. Personally, no one else gets a cut. That's kind of interesting, you know. So there's different ways that people have carved out spaces through reputation building where they retain some control of it in themselves, and you have to go to them. And that, I think, is, again, something that in the digital era, you don't necessarily, you have to be clever about how you do that. You can still do it. So that's one reason now why producers in hip hop often put their name in the hip hop tune somewhere in the beginning in the instrumental. You hear Mike Will made this or whatever it is, right? Because they know that their name needs to circulate because you can't get the metadata anymore. Like, you don't know if you buy a MP3 who the producer is necessarily. So the producers now are embedding their names in the songs, right? And that's not because they're going to get a royalty, although interestingly now maybe they will in the US, they just changed the law. But that's how they're going to build their reputation so that people will come to them in particular. So there's lots of examples like that. Any other questions? How are we doing? Well, do you have time for one more if there's? I don't know if there is. No? No? Okay. Are we good? I thought there'd be like a moderator. Okay. Thank you all so much. Thank you for your patience.